Welcome to our service of morning prayer for Temiskaming Deanery for the first Sunday in Lent, February 21st. My name is Derek Neal, and with me today in this service, I have the Reverend Val Paterson, who is our preacher, and the Reverend Dr. Peter Armstrong, who is the reader. And as before, Ms. Janet Parfitt is providing the music and singing. We shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Our first worship song is The Solid Rock.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest friend, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. In darkness there's His lovely face. I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath is covenant, is my support in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, He then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, rest in His righteousness.
Dear friends in Christ, as we prepare to worship Almighty God, let us with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by His infinite goodness and mercy. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against You in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved You with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of Your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in Your will and walk in Your ways, to the glory of Your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy.
Oh, come, let us worship. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your loving kindness. In your great compassion, blot out my offenses. Wash me through and through from my wickedness, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you only have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight. And so you are justified when you speak, and upright in your judgment. Indeed, I have been wicked from my birth, a sinner from my mother's womb. For lo, you look for truth deep within me, will make me to understand wisdom secretly. Purge me from my sin, and I shall be pure. Wash me, and I shall be clean indeed. Make me hear of joy and gladness, that the body you have broken may rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Give me the joy of your saving help again, and sustain me with your bountiful spirit. I shall teach your ways to the wicked, and sinners shall return to you. Deliver me from death, O God. My tongue shall sing of your righteousness, O God of my salvation. Open my lips, O Lord, and my mouth shall proclaim your praise. Had you desired it, I would have offered sacrifice. But you take no delight in burnt offerings. The sacrifice of God is a troubled spirit, a broken and a contrite spirit, O God, you will not despise.
The Lord is full of compassion and mercy.
O come, let us worship. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. My God, I put my trust in you.
Let me not be humiliated, nor let my enemies triumph over me.
Let none who look to you be put to shame.
Let the treacherous be disappointed in their schemes.
Show me your ways, O Lord. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. In you I have trusted all the day long. Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting. Remember not the sins of my youth and my transgressions. Remember me according to your love, for the sake of your goodness, O Lord. Gracious and upright is the Lord.
Therefore, he teaches sinners in his way.
He guides the humble in doing right.
And teaches his way to the lowly.
All the paths of the Lord are love and faithfulness.
To those who keep his covenant and his testimonies.
God of compassion and love, forgive our sins, relieve our misery, satisfy our longing, and fulfill our hopes for peace. Your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. First reading from Genesis 9, beginning at verse 8. God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you, that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood. Never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you, and every living creature that is with you, for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds. Shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Canticle 6, Seek the Lord. Seek the Lord while he wills to be found. Call upon him when he draws near. Let the wicked forsake their ways, and the evil ones their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and he will have compassion. To our God, for he will richly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as rain and snow fall from the heavens and return not again, but water the earth, bringing forth life and giving growth, seed for sowing and bread for eating, so is my word that goes forth from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but it will accomplish that which I purpose and prosper in that for which I sent it. Second reading is from the first letter of Peter, third chapter, beginning of verse 18. Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, which also he went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey. Well, God waited patiently in the days of Noah, during the building of the ark, which a few, that is, eight persons, were saved through water. And baptism, which this prefigured, now saves you. Not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience. Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Canticle 22, Jesus Christ is Lord. Christ Jesus, by nature divine, did not grasp for himself a rank as equal to God. He chose to empty himself, becoming a humble slave, living the life of a man and human in every way. He abased himself still more, obedient to death on a cross. So God has exalted him on high and given to him the name, the greatest of all names, so that at Jesus' name every knee should bend low, in heaven, on earth, in the depths, and every tongue proclaim Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Our next worship song, Thy Word.
I will love you to the end.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild beasts. And the angels waited on him. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be found acceptable to you, O Lord, our Savior and our Redeemer. Before I begin, I would like to give credit to the sources that I used in part for my reflection. First is a children's book, the Jesus Storybook Bible, written by Sally Lloyd-Jones. And secondly, is a podcast, Strange New World, hosted by Matthew Meyer Bolton. As of this past Wednesday, we are now in the time of Lent. The word Lent comes from an old English word, lengthen, for lengthen, and refers to the gradual lengthening of days of late winter and early spring. Over the centuries, Lent evolved into a 40-day period of reflection, repentance, and preparation for Holy Week, Easter Day, and the subsequent 50-day celebration of Eastertide. In the ancient days, 40 was a stylized way of saying for a long time. We could use this stylized way of expressing ourselves by saying something like, "I've got 40 days of food in my freezer, so I won't need to go shopping for 40 days or 40 years. Instead of saying, "I've got tons of food in my freezer and I don't need to go shopping for a month of Sundays." The 40 days of Lent resonates with other 40s found throughout the Old Testament. Moses's 40 days and nights on Mount Sinai, 40 years of the people of Israel wandering in the wilderness, and the two 40s that we hear about in today's readings, Noah and the 40 days and nights of rain in Genesis, and Jesus's 40 days of wilderness temptation that we read in Mark. The basic idea presented through these 40 stories is that our Creator God, like the master poet, choreographer, and composer that he is, works through discernible forms in time and space. And in the season of Lent, we're invited to participate in one of those forms by stepping into our own 40-day pilgrimage of reflection, repentance, prayer, and preparation for Easter. The mystery of Easter, the mystery of the resurrection, the mystery of the reason for it, and the mystery of the willingness of Jesus to go to his death on the cross, is the center of our Christian faith, and it is a love story. There are lots of stories in the Bible, but all the stories are telling one big story, the story of how God loves his children and comes to rescue them. So we begin to understand the mystery, we need to go to the beginning, to the oldest book of the Bible, Genesis, and the oldest gospel of the four, the book of Mark. In the beginning, God moved and created the world as a home for plants and trees, for creatures that lived in the sea and creatures that flew in the sky. God created animals of all kinds and shapes to live on the land of this home. And then finally, he created humans. The creation of the world was an act of hospitality. God moved over chaos and created a comfortable, life-giving place so that creatures could have a comfortable home. God formed humans in his divine image of hospitality, intelligence, and love to take care of his whole creation. When we get the call that company is coming, perhaps some of us have to move over the chaos of our homes, picking up old papers, vacuuming up the dog fur, remaking the beds in the guest room, all in the attempt to be hospitable. We want our homes to be a comfortable place where we can all relax in peace and have a good time together. Hospitality enables bonds to form. It helps connections to be made and a relationship to develop with our guests. And that is what God wants. He wants to be with us so that we can enjoy each other's company with him. Emmanuel, God with us, didn't start on Christmas Day. God was with us at the beginning, at creation. Our God is a creative, gracious host, shepherding us through the ups and downs of life, longing for all of us, all his creation together, to enjoy each other's company with him. But humans turned away from this relationship with God and with each other and became catastrophically lost. Sin had come into God's perfect world and it would never leave. It mutated God's perfect creation into something totally wrong. As time passed, the Lord saw how great humans' wickedness on the earth had become, and that every inclination in the thoughts of their hearts was only evil all the time. The whole earth was corrupt in God's sight and was full of violence. A grieving God with his loving heart broken, filled with pain, did not want to give up on people and his creation. But as it became more and more deviant, more and more violent, God knew he must begin again. Do you remember your nursery? Was it painted pink or blue? Yellow or mauve? Did you have stuffed animals and books and toy cars and games? Over on the wall in the corner of your room, did you have a picture of a little boat with animals, their heads sticking out all through the windows, and Noah and his wife standing on the deck, and a dove perched on the top of the roof? Did the blue and green, red and yellow glow in the rainbow that arced over that boat? What a cute little picture, and what a cute little story. But wait a minute. What's so cute about a story of death and mass destruction? A picture of little scraps of life holding on in a boat while all living flesh is destroyed by a flood all around them that was sent by God. What's so beautiful about a rainbow that could be taken as a reminder that God could do this again. The story of Noah could have been a grim, dark, hopeless story of a punishing God, but it isn't, because God isn't like that. The story of Noah is a hopeful, inspiring, forgiving, creative love story, because our God is like that. God does not love violence. He abhors violence and chaos. He moved over chaos and turned it into a beautiful creation, a garden. But when sin entered into that creation, violence entered, and it became so strong and hateful. He could not bear even the thought of his beloved children living like that forever. He longed for his creation to live as a peaceable kingdom. And so he went back to square one, to the beginning. The waters covered the earth, and the reprise began. Noah became a new Adam, given the responsibility of stewardship, a caretaker host for all the other creatures, making sure they had all they needed to survive. And when it was over, the earth dried out. And with God's archer bow hung in the sky as a sign, God renounces violence and declares that peace is the covenant promise. God promised, "Never again will I destroy all living creatures. I will remember my covenant between me and you and all living creatures of every kind." It was a new beginning. This is the first covenant, without conditions, totally one-sided, from God alone. We have to do nothing in return. In this promise, this bond, he wants to be connected to all his creation in such a way as to create faith and confidence in him and peace amongst his creatures. He wants to be trusted as a loving father that he is, and that all flesh will not have to live in perpetual fear of a repetition of the kind of catastrophe that was the flood. God's truly in love for us, with us. God's treaty of love for us, for peace, for salvation, for all creation, is a worldwide treaty, excluding none, a bond of his love for all. This strong love for us and all creation is the good news. But it wasn't long before everything went wrong again. God knew it would, but he had a rescue plan. His strong anger against hate and sadness, violence and death would come down once more, but not on his people, not on his world. He promised it wouldn't. That archer's bow would not be pointed down at his people. Instead, it would be pointed up to the heart of heaven. Mark's story is a new beginning. In some ways, it echoes Noah's story. It begins with the water of baptism. The Greek word baptize translates to drown, but baptism is also a kind of new beginning, a new creation and restart. Jesus comes up out of the waters, the heavens open, and the dove comes down and rests on Jesus, as the voice of God is heard to say, "This is my beloved child. I love him. I am well pleased with him. Listen to him." Mark says that Jesus is immediately sent out by the Spirit into the wilderness for 40 days and tempted by Satan. He was with the wild beasts, similar to Noah and his 40 days with the beasts in the ark. And after the struggles in the desert, Jesus's public ministry begins by graciously reminding people of the original good news, the rainbow covenant of God's unconditional universal love, calling them back, to turn back to God and believe and have faith in him. The time has come, he says. The peaceable kingdom of God is near. It's breaking through. Jesus's earthly ministry ends with the mystery of Easter, the mystery of the cross, and the empty tomb. On the eve of his death, Jesus will proclaim a new covenant for the forgiveness of sins. That new covenant is the rescue plan for the whole world. It doesn't cancel out the first covenant. It's a fulfillment of God's first covenant. It brings us back to the basics, the peaceable kingdom, a life lived with God in relationship with him and with others and with the creatures of the earth. The mystery of Easter is a vast story, thousands of years in the making. It's like a huge mural full of color. But this is the place to begin, looking at the wide brushstrokes. First of all, God's gracious, hospitable desire to live with us and enjoy each other's company. Second, God's boundless, peaceful covenant of forgiveness. And third, our key calling as custodians of creation. As we explore this greatest of mysteries, Easter, we need to remember that each one of us is a beloved child of God in whom God is well pleased. And that is where the mystery of Easter begins. Let us pray. Taking this prayer from the book. Dear God, we want to know you and be close to you. Please show us how. Make everything in the world right again, and in our hearts too. Do what is best, just like you do in heaven, and please do it down here too. Please give us everything we need today. Forgive us for doing wrong, for hurting you. Forgive us just as we forgive other people when they hurt us. Rescue us. We need you. We don't want to keep running away and hiding from you. Keep us safe from our enemies. You're strong, God. You can do whatever you want. You are in charge, now and forever and for always. We think you're great. Amen.
Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love and the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts, we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages.
Amen. Let us pray with confidence and trust, not in ourselves, but in the God whom we love and serve with all our lives. Let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy.
We pray to you, Lord.
Lord of the Church, we pray for your one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church throughout the world, and especially for the communion to which we belong. Pour your grace into our broken lives, so that we may become the body and the bride which you want us to be above all else. Bless, we pray, Anne, our Metropolitan, and all the parishes represented in Temiscaming Deanery. Particularly in this season of Lent, help us to see ourselves as you see us, in deep need of your saving work in our lives. Transform us, we humbly pray, by the Spirit of your Son, Jesus Christ. To you belongs all honor, praise, and glory. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Dear Heavenly Father, forgive us of our complacency, of our common neglect in witnessing to your unbounded mercy shown through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Help us to recall the depth of our need and the height of your transforming love. And give us, we pray, grateful hearts for all you have done for us. Help us not only to see ourselves in need of you, but all people. We pray passionately for the mission of your church in all places, so that lives and communities will be transformed by the gospel of your Son. We pray for the faithful witness of your church, that we may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Gracious God, help us to use our minds for the advancement of your purposes. Especially in this season of Lent, help us to focus carefully on how we may deepen our relationship with you. We pray that our faith may be deepened. For those who are considering the claims of the gospel, we pray that they will see not only the cost, but the eternal benefits of lives given wholly in your service. Bless those preparing for holy baptism, and for confirmation, for their teachers, and for their sponsors. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord of the nations, we pray earnestly for the glorious day when your kingdom shall fully come, and your will is done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray for those in positions of political authority, that they may seek the common good, that the values of this world may more faithfully reflect the priorities of heaven. At this time, O Lord, we pray for those who oversee for the distribution of vaccines, for those responsible for education, for businesses large and small. We pray for peace and for justice everywhere, particularly in those places of poverty and conflict, and in circumstances of racial injustice. We pray for your spirit of reconciliation to be among Indigenous and non-Indigenous people in Canada. We pray that a spirit of respect and reconciliation may grow among all nations and peoples. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord of mercy, your Son experienced grievous pain and alienation on the cross as the redemption of the world was won. We pray for the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, especially those who suffer during this present pandemic, and many others we remember in our hearts this time. We pray for the victims of violence, for the perpetrators, for those who are in any kind of prison, for refugees, for the persecuted and the persecutors, for all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Acknowledging our deep need for you, we admit our own petty failures, times when we've injured or offended others by our speech or in our conduct. Give us eyes to see. Change our hearts from iron to flesh. We pray humbly for reconciliation and renewal of relationships whenever we have hurt others, even unintentionally. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Heavenly Father, help us not only to see what is behind us, but the opportunities which lie in front of us. Give us grace, we pray, to amend our lives and to further the reign of God. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Grant this our prayer, O Father, for through the unique merits and perfect mediation of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, to whom belongs all honor and glory, world without end.
Amen. Almighty God, whose Son fasted 40 days in the wilderness and was tempted as we are, but did not sin, give us grace to discipline ourselves in submission to your Spirit, that as you know our weakness, so we may know your power to save. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Lord God, almighty and everlasting Father, you have brought us in safety to this new day. Preserve us with your mighty power, that we may not fall into sin or be overcome by adversity. And in all we do, direct us to the fulfilling of your purpose. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and abide with you this day and forevermore.
Amen.
Our final worship song is What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Jesus. alone again. Precious Savior, still our refuge. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake me? Take it to the Lord.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.